He's probably go down in history as one of the finest stylists ever to write on the court. I would place him second among all the justices. The 108th that sat on the court, the first one was Cardozo, who had a penchant for poetry and prose, which was really, and so did Jackson. That is really what has always drawn me to him, and his opinions are superb, they're clear, they're lawyer-like, they're pristine, and they always contain a memorable statement of one type or another. Any student who is interested at all in good writing could and would turn to Jackson. The fact that he is not always regarded as a great, in quotes, in terms of those who make it their business to critique the court, is due to the fact that his tenure was relatively brief, 13 years. See, if you compare that, for example, to John Marshall's 34, or Black's 30, Hughes's close to that, it makes it very difficult. Also, he, of course, was gone for a year at Nuremberg, which exacerbated his controversy with Black and made the court's role somewhat difficult because a number of cases were tie cases. So they had a large segment of 4-4 cases, which meant that the court itself really couldn't decide, that the highest decision below would then govern. That was a source of controversy, and the fact that Black and Jackson were hostile towards one another anyway, because of, in a number of ways they both had aspired to and failed to achieve the chief justiceship. FDR apparently had promised it to both. And that's not surprising. I'm sure he promised to do a few other people too. But he decided he couldn't do that. It's always dicey to promote someone from inside the court. Although he did at that time, he appointed Stone. Stone was a liberal Republican. He was the only Republican on the bench at the time, because FDR nominated 9 people. There were 9 of his were on the bench. That's the second highest number. George Washington had 14. Of whom 11 served. And Black and Jackson were at each other's throat. They disagreed in certain kinds of cases. They disagreed in certain procedures. And Jackson's absence at Nuremberg, I think, caused many of the half a dozen or 10 or so rankings, ratings that took place to regard him not in the, quote, great category, but near great. And I noticed that your story picked that up right away. Not too much attention should be paid to that, you know, but when you're in a league with people who've served for 30 years and, you know, and were a remarkable jurist during that time, it becomes very difficult to crack it. Anyway, as a near grade, he's in very good company. He's with Brennan and he's with Douglas and Harlan, you know, so they're not to be sneered at. He contributed a great deal to the concept of crimes of war and war crimes generally and crimes against humanity. He helped to write the code that was used in Nuremberg. And as our prosecutor there, he was a towering figure. There are some who've criticized him, mostly on the British side, that while he delivered his prosecution speeches superbly, in cross-examination, he wasn't what they thought he should have been, but I've never paid much attention to that. He was a great speaker and was very impressive. And he had an interesting team in Nuremberg, of course. Our judge, the American judge in Nuremberg, was Francis Biddle, who was Attorney General under Roosevelt. And Senator Dodd of Connecticut's father was on his team. And so was Michael Massimano, a colorful Pennsylvania jurist. Jackson, you know, Jackson will always be remembered, and I suspect long after I'm gone, he will, in the years, history will remember him, I think, more for having been our prosecutor at Nuremberg than they will as having been a Supreme Court justice, with the one exception that his wonderful style, majestic language will always be recorded. You know, he proved that law could be literature and that literature could be law, and he was very successful in that. So it's wonderful that Jamestown has honored him the way it is doing, and of course they should have. Only one other person seems to be honored more by Jamestown, and that is Lucille Ball, you know, I guess, if that's the case, yes.
With some of the topics that we were saying that we were probably going to have to be rushing out here for to take a look at what's going on with Iraq and the U.S. and mm-hmm. Britain and so forth, do you foresee any of the codes and the war crimes issues being brought up soon?
Yeah, oh, yes. President Bush brought it up in his speech, because he made quite clear there would be no escape from responsibility, that the Allies would not accept the finger pointing that was so prevalent in Germany. I was an examiner of prisoners of war. I was, for a while, I was on a team that interviewed German prisoners of war, you know, and of course we were only allowed to ask three questions, name, rank, and serial number. But they would speak quite frequently, and the first thing that came out, we didn't know what was going on, and that was, you know, that was, it was only Hitler, you see, and so we didn't know. But Bush made quite clear he wouldn't accept that sort of thing, that from his point of view, anyone who was involved would be regarded as a participant, and consequently would have to find some consequences. So I think it will play a role. If and when we finish with this particular war, I think you'll see references to war crimes. And after all, the tribunals are in place already. We have this brand new court. America is not part of it at the moment, you know, but there's the old court of The Hague. We are part of that. And I think there's no question that if Saddam Hussein is ever captured, or if he loses, as I hope he does, everyone expects him to, I think he will stand in the docket now. Maybe he'll choose a course of action like Goering and take a cyanide pill, you know. And, but I think that's no question. And Nuremberg will be the precedent for it. And that's, again, is a contribution that Jackson helped to render. He wasn't the only one. He had a lot of help from the British and to some extent, a minor extent, the French jurists and the Russians too. And they had a big London conference that I recall in which Jackson played a major role. You know. So he will be remembered for that more than perhaps for, although, you know, he was a dissenter in the Japanese evacuation case in a very famous dissenting opinion. The vote was 6-3 and the case was written by his nemesis, Justice Black, who was a leading liberal, but who felt that the country had to accept the fact that in wartime there were some stringent needs that could and would or normally not be acceptable. But Jackson, of course, said that this was guilt by association and that the Japanese could not escape from the race into which they were born and they should not be punished for being Japanese. So, and I think he'll be remembered for that. And he wrote some major opinions all along the liberal route. You know, he was very much opposed to compulsory flag saluting and things of that type. But I think when you speak of Nuremberg and war crimes, the name Jackson will obviously come along.
Have we seen a lot of that with the trial of Milosevic in the court?
Well, he, of course, you know, he falls under that rubric. They haven't been able to do much with him. You know, he's conceited. He has defenders. He is, you know, he's very elusive. And ultimately, I guess there'll be some kind of a verdict. Apparently, the assassin who killed, you know, the very remarkable Serbian prime minister, belong to a group that hasn't been completely established, but apparently he belonged to a group that had always been opposed to Milosevic's arrest and deportation. So
we have yet to have that one play out.
Pardon me?
We have yet to have that one play out then.
Oh yes, no, that isn't finished yet. But the concept of guilt, of having to stand, having to acknowledge participation in proscribed behavior is one which is now part and parcel, I think, of our international scene. And again, you know, Jackson was very helpful in establishing the necessary code. visualize a textbook, you know, if they're still books, then, you know, if it isn't all on the computer or whatever. I was going to say that, you know, a Supreme Court justice played a major role in the war crimes trial. His name was Robert A. Jackson. He was from a small New York town, you see, or some such thing. And went to law school but didn't finish because he was bored. And he went on to become a great lawyer. Yeah. That's the sort of thing that I think. Now, the historians will keep him alive in different ways, too, I'm sure. And so will the political scientists. But and after all, he was one of, at that time, one of only about 90 members who have sat on the Supreme Court. We've had 108 now. And that isn't all that many. You know, the average tenure of a Supreme Court justice is 23 years. I once played a little game with a research assistant. I said, well, can you try to find out what other identifiable professional groups have had as longevity? And he dug and came up with the conclusion that the only identifiable professional group that had a greater longevity period than Supreme Court justices were symphony conductors. I guess because they use their hands a lot, you know, and circulation goes through. So that was not one of my more memorable research projects, but it was a lot of fun. So 23 years, see, and again, Jackson didn't reach that average, you know.
Right, he was 13, including the time that he was at Nuremberg.
Yeah, well, he lost 1 year at Nuremberg, right. And then he died young, I mean, relatively young. He, you know, how old was he? In his 60s,
62, maybe, I think.
Yeah. But he still participated in Brown v. Board, you know, in the desegregation case, public school desegregation case in 54. He participated in that and participated in Brown v. Board II, but then died en route to the court. But he had taken part in that case. And that was a unanimous decision, it was 9-0. Warren wrote it. And it took 2 years to bring that, because Warren was not going to present a conclusion or a case that was in any way a divided court. And Justice Reed held out for a long time. Actually, Justice Jackson had some doubts about the case, as Chief Justice Rehnquist can attest if he wants to. And of course, Rehnquist himself wrote a memo which strongly urged Jackson not to vote in favor of an abolition of the status quo. And Rehnquist got into trouble because of that during his nomination hearings, both as Associate Justice and Chief Justice. But Jackson had some real doubts about it, but he went along. It was Reed who was the last holdout. He took 20 lunches with Chief Justice Warren. And finally, Reed said, I'll do it for America. And it was 9-0. And the implementation case was also 9-0. Frankfurter wrote most of that one, but it went over Warren's signature. So, and Warren was smart in not handing down a divided case, because if you would have had a 6-3 or 7-2 or 5-4 decision, the impact would have been very, very, very regrettable. You see. Mm. So.
Is that one opinion that maybe stands above the rest in terms of Jackson's involvement that you think he contributed, or what?
I don't know how much Jackson was involved in the framing of the case. Perhaps not too much, but I do know that he had some real doubts about it, as did many other people, especially with some of the language that the Chief Justice finally adopted, such as that segregation affects a child's ability to learn, and that compulsory segregation has a deleterious effect. And you know, there are sociologists who disagree with that, and nowadays you have situations in which schools have become one racial again, you know, sometimes by choice and sometimes by the accident of geography. And Jackson, as I said, had some real doubts, but he went along. He thought the fairness of it was overwhelming.
Now, did he think that it would have been just better to have ruled on strict 14th Amendment grounds without commenting on the whole?
Well, that's one.
I mean, you know, a lot of people sort of
perhaps that might have been the better part of wisdom, but the Chief Justice felt, and I think quite rightly, had to explain the reasons more. Cases like that command a fairly lengthy analysis, although Warren v. Board was not a long case, you know. Warren was a better executive and a better leader than he was a Chief Justice, or as a justice. You know, he didn't write all that well. He didn't have the intellectual acumen of, let's say, a Black or a Jackson. He certainly didn't write as beautifully as Jackson did. He didn't have the same sense of history, but he was a real leader. He was an educator, that's what he did. And the opinion is a fairly brief opinion, and the implementation decision, Brown v. Board 2, is only a few pages. You know, that was, as I said, mostly written by Frankfurter. And the solution that there has to be a prompt and reasonable start, you know, that Frankfurter found in a tax case written by Holmes, you know, as a kind of solution. Normally, the really difficult cases command a lot of writing. Perhaps it would have been better to have a real short case, you know, which is what you're suggesting. But I think the criticism would have gone far beyond what it already evoked. You know,
sure.
It took a long time. It was not till 1964, you know, 10 years after Brown v. Board, that the last school district became theoretically desegregated, at least. Because, you know, until the case was decided, the legal situation was based on a case called Plessy versus Ferguson, 1896, you know, in which Harlan was the only dissenter in 8-1. And Harlan said, you know, in the famous dissenting opinion, that everything should be race neutral, you know. Constitution is colorblind, he wrote, and neither knows nor advances racial segregation or something like that. Now, theoretically, that should be true today. The Constitution is colorblind, but it isn't, you know, especially certainly not when you have structures like affirmative action. That's color conscious, you know, it's not color blind. It would be interesting to see what Harlan I would have said today, how he would have voted. His grandson, of course, disagreed with his grandfather on a lot of issues. Grandson was much more conservative. He was very proud of his grandfather, but whereas the grandfather was a major figure in the nationalization of the Bill of Rights, the grandson did not think that was any business of the court, that the state should be permitted to conduct their own particular approaches to the problem. But Harlan II, as I said before, was in the same group as Jackson, sort of a near-grade jurist. He was a wonderful person and a good friend of Robert Jackson's. And the grandfather was a strange man, but he was, you know, he had a half-black brother, and he was both on the side of the Union and on the side of the South, and he had slaves at one time, and then he let them go, and he was a conservative individual for a while, then he became ultra-liberal, and in his later years, he became very liberal. And one of the things I did, which I've regretted, I had a letter from a lawyer in New York by the name of Morris Ernst. He was in a big New York law firm, because I had written an article in which I had said that Justice John Marshall Harlan I had undergone a major metamorphosis in his political and judicial consciousness. He had turned from being a conservative to a very liberal jurist. And Mr. Ernst wrote and said, how do you account for that? Well, the letter came at a bad time. I was grading papers and I was being flippant in my reply. And I suggested, well, perhaps among other things, it was old age when people become sometimes a little more mellow. That's not always true either, of course. And he wrote back, dear Abraham, and I hate that salutation anyway, and I still have the letter, served me by dear Abraham, colon, I do not believe in the male menopause. Sincerely, Morris Ernst. I still have that.
No, is this the founding partner of Ernst & Young?
What's that?
Is this the partner for which Ernst & Young is named after?
The firm was Ernst, Wolf, Greenbaum, and Ernst, I think. A big New York firm. I think it still exists. Well, he's long gone, but I still have his letter.
is there a decision that jumps out from your mindset when it comes to Jackson, when you say Robert Jackson, that preeminent piece of literature, what would it be?
Well, it would be West Virginia Board of Education versus Barnett. That would jump out at me because of his magnificent language in the case and his dissenting opinion in Korematsu versus the United States, you know, when he said that guilt is not inheritable, guilt is personal. Mm-hmm. And that Korematsu cannot escape from the race into which he was born. And in the West Virginia case, that was just wonderful, you know. And I've quoted it twice last night and once this morning when he said, those who begin coercive elimination of dissent will soon find themselves eliminating dissenters. Compulsory unification of opinion achieves only the unanimity of the graveyard. You know, I would always think of that. But there were many others. And then, of course, post-Nuremberg, his famous dissenting opinion in the Chicago case involving a fascist group, Gerald L.K. Smith's group, when he said, unless this court commits itself to some common sense, it will turn the Constitutional Bill of Rights into a suicide pact. I'm going to quote that on Saturday when I'm on a panel about free speech in wartime, you know, and so forth. Mm-hmm. So. And I'm going to be in trouble because I'm on a panel with four people and they're all after me. As soon as I say that, I'm going to be in trouble. But that's all right. I'm used to being there.
How influential was Jackson in in the widening of the court's interpretation of the Commerce Clause?
Oh, well, that's a good question. He backed national government's extensive power over interstate commerce. It's interesting that you would mention that. You know, that's an area which we always taught. And of course, the Commerce Clause had been turned into a catch-all authority for any kind of legislation, interstate and foreign commerce. It's only lately that it has seen a little bit of an abridgment. Mm-hmm. And that is why I mentioned this morning in my talks upstairs over there the fact that on the federalism issue, this court has become much more pro-state. Mm-hmm. And part of it is they have not been unwilling, 5-4, to harness the Commerce Clause. Mm-hmm. Jackson wrote some very important decisions in the Commerce Clause. In an agricultural case, Wickard versus Filburn.
The famous one.
You remember
is he the one
name?
Who wrote the opinion in that? Is he the one who wrote the opinion?
He wrote the opinion.
Oh, okay.
It was unanimous, you know. And he said that, how did he put it? When interstate commerce feels a pinch, anyway, I can't quite repeat his exact clause. His point was, if there's any effect at all on interstate commerce, no matter how remote, as long as interstate commerce feels the pinch, that's sufficient to center federal authority. So he gave a very broad interpretation to federal legislative authority in the analysis of the powers under the Interstate Commerce Clause. Wickard v. Filburn, I think, was a 1943 case, something like that.
It was a foreign price control case, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. And he, so he was all with the New Deal, you know. He was a very faithful interpreter of the New Deal. And that's one of the reasons Roosevelt felt so close to him, you know. And when Jackson reached the court, you know, that was, of course, by that time the court had been pretty well secure. Because as soon as Black got on in 1937, he led what has been called so effectively the switch in time that that saved nine, you know. That was in the Jones and Laughlin case, when interstate commerce, you know, was
first
regarded.
It was Charles Hughes Evans who wrote the decision, didn't he? Charles Evans Hughes who wrote the decision?
Hughes was the one who had held very steadfast against a broad interpretation of the commerce power. But in the Jones and Laughlin case, you know, he managed to get Roberts to come around, and so he wrote the opinion. Yeah. And Jackson was always a secure vote for a broad interpretation of the commerce power. That really became sort of the national authority to pass legislation in the economic field.
Sure.
And he was,
in any field, eventually.
Any field, you know. They used the commerce power, God knows what they, anything. In the civil rights legislation, much of that was passed in 64 under the commerce power, you know. And the Supreme Court handed down his opinion in, Katzenbach versus McClung, and Heart of Atlanta versus something or other. The question arose, you know, can a motel that is on the public highway between the Atlanta airport and Atlanta, can they bar blacks from occupancy? And the court 9-0 said, of course you can't, because that's part of interstate commerce. Congress had a right to forbid that kind of action. But the second case had gone the other way below. At the Ollie McClung was a barbecue place in the woods, and they segregated blacks, and blacks brought suit, and the lower court upheld the right of McClung to do what he wanted. They said it was not an interstate commerce. It was just a little old shack place in the woods.
Right.
Well, the legislation provided, among other things, if you were selling meat in the form of hamburgers or whatever else, if the percentage of the meat imported from out of state exceeded a certain amount, that placed you into interstate commerce. So that too became a 9-0 opinion. Although there were some indications that a number of the justices weren't too happy with that.
They just felt that was kind of the logic of their
They fell into line, you know. Mm. So. So, and as I said, Jackson could always be counted upon to vote, you know, with the administration. With the administration. He was a faithful soldier in the New Deal concept. Now, of course, he wasn't alive in the case I just described, because that was 64. No, he died in 54. His son delivered the lectures he had written, you know, I've forgotten the name of the little book I have at home. It was an analysis of how the American public stood with regard to civil rights and liberties. And I remember he said the public was not too enlightened about the significance of civil rights and liberties.
This was Jackson?
Jackson wrote that, yeah. The lectures were delivered at Harvard, I think. I mentioned them last night in my talk. It had a long name. And that's, you know, it's a beautifully written piece, and his son delivered them. It's a shame he didn't live longer, you know. If he had another 10 years or so, it may have made a major difference how he's viewed. You know.
Now, who replaced him on the court? I don't even know that.
Who replaced Jackson? That was in 54. Let's see, Eisenhower came on in 52.
White, maybe?
One in 52. No, White was a Kennedy appointment later on. White came on in 63. I think it may have been Harlan came on in 56. It was either, let's see, that was, he died in 54. It must have been either Brennan or Harlan. Oh, I don't know whether it has the book here. Oh, here it is. Jackson was number 86 in 54. Now let's see who came on in 54. 54. Let's see, 54. It was Harlan who replaced him, yeah, in 55. He was Eisenhower's second appointment. His first one was Warren, then came Harlan, then Brennan, then Whitaker, as I said. And I didn't mention Stuart. He was the fifth. Yeah, so Harlan was in the post-Nuremberg-Jackson jurisprudential tradition, pretty much. But he would not have voted with Jackson in a great many of the civil liberties cases. He was much more conservative than Jackson was. But also a fine writer and a terrific person. Mm-hmm. He was on the court from 54 to 71. He and Black died within a few weeks of one another and were both at Walter Reed Hospital. Yeah. And the last time they were together, they were debating the nationalization of the Bill of Rights. You know, Black was for it and Harlan was against it.
Interesting.
Yeah, he was, some good books have been published on Harlan. A colleague of mine, Tinsley Yarbrough, has written a wonderful book on the second. He also wrote a book on the first, Harlan.
Is it correct that Harlan the second replaced Jackson? Did you talk about that?
Yeah, Rehnquist, that's
that was the connector. Okay.
Just Harlan came on in 55. Mm-hmm. And Jackson died in 54.
Right.
Didn't he? In June or July, something like that. And then Harlan was nominated. Harlan was Eisenhower's second nominee. Warren was the first. He was repaid a debt for throwing the convention to Eisenhower rather than Taft. So,
can I switch gears for a second? Are you one of the first book authored by Robert H. Jackson was The Struggle for Judicial Supremacy, which was sort of that apology, if you will, or apologia for Franklin Roosevelt's court packing bill.
Yes.
In your research, did you get a sense that Jackson was 100% behind this, or principally because of his role?
I think he was playing the good soldier. Mm-hmm. That's why I said last night, in my judgment, he would really, had he been on the court when this was going on, he would have opposed Roosevelt's plan. He would have gone right along with the other justices. But he was the good soldier, and we had just talked about his approach to the commerce power, which was very generous and very broad. It was all pro-New Deal. So I think he was playing the role of good soldier, and he was also still hoping, you know, to become Chief Justice. Wanted to be a good boy. I don't think he was persuaded completely, but I'm quite sure that he didn't doubt it very much. He wanted to go along. And Frankfurter was very equivocal about it. But Jackson didn't hesitate in supporting it, but I don't think his heart was in it, you know, completely. I can't vouchsafe for that, you know, but I don't think it was. Anyway, he advanced it, he supported it. He was in the Roosevelt administration, and in 37, when this was going on, I don't know whether his attorney general, no, he was still solicitor general, I think. So he was a member of the team, and after all, some of the great constitutionalists supported it, like Edward S. Corwin, whom Roosevelt apparently promised an appointment to the court, despite the fact that Corwin didn't have a law degree.
Right. You know.
And Corwin really thought he was going to the court. But he didn't, and he was not happy about it. Mm-hmm.
We're doing this filming for the archives, and one of the things we just skipped over is the fact that people 20 years from now will have just heard this, and they won't know what we're talking about. Could you, as a good professor, give us a little overview on February 7th, 1937, President Roosevelt actually introduced into Congress?
Well, he introduced the court packing legislation, which would have provided one additional justice for every justice who was 70 years old, up to a total of 15. That would have meant that he could have appointed 6 new justices, and you may be sure they would have all been loyal New Dealers, you see. As it stood, he couldn't count on very many votes on the court at the time. he could count on, well, Cardozo was still living for part of the time, and so it's Brandeis, and he could count on, that was about it at the time. There just weren't any others. The others were more or less under the direction of Hughes, and Roberts was his good soldier. And then, of course, you had the four arch conservatives, you know, the so-called four horsemen. They were Van der Vander, Sutherland, Butler, and let's see, McReynolds, you know. And they were curmudgeons of the First Order. Now, Sutherland and Van der Vander were really quite pro-civil liberties, but the big issues, of course, were not civil liberties or civil rights. Big issues were the New Deal. And that court struck down 16 pieces of New Deal legislation in a 13-month period. And Roosevelt went out of his mind, you know. He was not a religious man, but he would bow down with his heavy, damaged knees and pray at night that something would happen, but nothing happened, you see, until finally Van der Vander decided to retire. They had put a companion bill into the court packing bill, which made retirement easier. And Van der Vander took advantage of that in 37, and Hugo Black got the job. And when Roosevelt told Steve Early, his press secretary, whom he had appointed to take the place, Early said, "Jesus Christ," because it was Black, you see, with his Ku Klux Klan background and all. And then there ensued a horrendous battle. But Black went off to Europe with his wife, his first wife, and then he came home. He gave a major address to the country, commenting on the allegations about his past. That was the radio broadcast that received a larger number of voters, of listeners, than any other broadcast except the abdication of King Edward, the seventh, whatever it was, anyway, to marry the woman he loved, namely Warfield Simpson from Baltimore, for whom he gave up the throne. Thank God, you know, because he turned out to be a pretty rotten figure, and so did she. Probably good in bed, but that has nothing to do with the rest of the business. Congress was given this hot potato by the president, and it was introduced on the floor by his loyal soldiers, such as the floor leader, Robinson of Arkansas, and others. And it was sent to committee, and the committee buried it. In part, it was buried it for a while. It did get to the floor, but committee gave it a hostile reception. Part of that was due to the fact that Roosevelt's main complaint about the court was, it was not an honest complaint, was that they were too old to do the job and that they were behind in their casework, mm-hmm. which is simply not true. And the Chief Justice Hughes wrote a bitter letter, you know, about that, joined by Brandeis, who was one of the Roosevelt supporters, outraged that they were being told they were behind in their work, you see. That elicited a number of major senatorial backers, such as Senator Wheeler of Montana. I remember him. He was not a nice guy, but he was pretty principled on that issue. And the court packing bill seemed to be pretty doomed. What happened then on the floor of the Senate, the majority leader, Robinson, who was a candidate for the Supreme Court, dropped dead. The bill was recommitted to the committee, and they buried it. You see, it never came out again. However, by that time, I guess Justice Van der Vander, seeing the new retirement bill, had decided, I'll just get out of all this mess. His departure meant that a new appointment could make all the difference in the world, and Roosevelt picked Senator Hugo Black, Hugo Lafayette Black from Alabama. And then, as I said, he went off to Europe and came home and made that famous statement and said, after my comments are ended, I shall never again refer to that problem. That was his Ku Klux Klan business. And he kept the faith and the word. He was on the court for 34 years and a couple of months, and he would never make a comment, no matter how often people tried to interview him on that. And of course, he turned out to be the leading liberal on the bench until he, very far along in his old age, commentators claim, and a number of my colleagues do, that he became conservative in some of his votes on the civil rights and liberties horizon. I don't think so. I think he was quite consistent. They especially charge him with becoming conservative in some of the search and seizure cases. But that Fourth Amendment is such a can of worms anyway, you know, what is reasonable and what is not reasonable. So he became the leader of the court. He always wanted to be Chief Justice, and so did Jackson. And Roosevelt was fond of both, and, you know, and supported them both, and I'm sure told both of them he'd appoint him to the court. But as I said, in a different connection, presidents are usually well advised not to advance a member of the sitting justices, because it always causes problems. And since Stone was the last one to be promoted. That was in 1941. He died on the court in 46. And the next chief justices all came from the outside. First came Vinson, then came Warren, then came Berger. Now, Rehnquist was promoted, because he was the last one. And that caused no problem in the court. It caused a lot of problems in the Senate. But, you know, while he had a large number of votes against him, it was not as many as Hughes had against him when he was appointed chief justice. And anyway, they had been through Rehnquist as an associate justice. I remember that was the first time that the American Civil Liberties Union became inconsistent with its creed. They opposed a person for an appointment, you know, and they lost a lot of members at the time, but they gained a lot of others.
Franklin Roosevelt feel that his experiment on the court packing bill was a worthwhile one, in that the even though the bill didn't pass, the results that he wanted to get, he got?
He, I'm not sure whether he thought he would win the way he did, you know, same as switching time that saved nine. But I think his campaign must have convinced Hughes that it was time to look at that legislation a little differently, especially since it was based on the commerce power, you see. Most of those declarations of unconstitutionality were based on the contention that the federal government had unconstitutionally utilized the commerce power. But then came Jackson's famous opinion in Wicked v. Filburn, when he said, whenever interstate commerce is pinched, no matter, you know, how heavy or how light, I don't have the exact quotation in my mind at the moment. That was in 1943, I think, and when he upheld the Agricultural Adjustment Act. And he was a champion in interpreting commerce power broadly. Well, Roosevelt needed someone who would provide that kind of jurisprudence. And Justice Black, there was no question about it. He had been a very loyal New Deal senator in the Senate. And so that introduced the switching time. Hughes was ready to move over in 1937. And he talked Roberts into coming along in the famous National Labor Relations case versus Jones and Loughlin. And it was then that Roosevelt saw or thought he could push things, because Hughes was coming around anyway. But he didn't need the court packing bill anymore, but he still, it was there. It was in the docket when the Jones and Loughlin came down, but Roosevelt didn't withdraw it because, you know, someone might have died and he might have been in the same pickle again. But he didn't get anywhere. I don't know whether he thought he could win. His attorney general at the time wrote the bill. His name was Cummings. He was a UVA graduate. He and Cummings must have thought that it was important to push it at least. And Hughes, I think, was listening and looking. And he was a good leader on the court and very influential. And Roberts was the one he had to get around, and Roberts finally did. Started to come around it in the Milk case from New York earlier, but it took till 1937, till Jones and Laughlin. And of course, that's when Van de Vanda, I guess, threw in the towel and Black came on. And then the others ultimately stepped down, either died, or the last one to go down, I think, was Butler. McReynolds was a horrible man. He was the worst of the four. He was a Democrat, Attorney General under Wilson, and Wilson began to dislike him so much and was so upset with his stewardship in that office that he wanted to get rid of him, but he found it politically almost impossible. So what did he do? He promoted him to the Supreme Court. He foisted McReynolds, you know, on the Supreme Court. And that was something.
Banishment.
McReynolds turned out to be the biggest bigot ever to sit on the court. If you wanted to be a clerk for McReynolds, you could not be or do the following. You couldn't be Black or Asian. You couldn't be Jewish or Catholic. You couldn't be married. You couldn't be engaged. You couldn't smoke. You couldn't drink. He left out one thing. I don't know whether he was familiar with that, but otherwise, you know, that's... And he was just a bigot of the first order in his comments. When Brandeis got on the bench, he refused to have his picture taken, the court picture taken. He said he wasn't going to sit next to a Hebrew in a photograph. And then when Cardozo came on, he said, not another one. And he turned his back when Cardozo was invested, you know, with the gowns. And whenever Brandeis recited, Brandeis came on in 1916, and McReynolds, I think, got on in 1914 or so. Whenever Brandeis recited, McReynolds would leave the room, you see. And they had a barber shop in the Supreme Court, they still do. It was a Black barber, and one day he said to him, "Say, can you tell me the name of that nigger university downtown?" And of course, he was referring to Howard, you know. And well, but my father always said there's something good in everybody. When McReynolds died all alone and abandoned, and only a clerk came to the funeral, the justices didn't come to the funeral, which is really a no-no, you know, but they did. He had left most of his money to charitable institutions in Washington, and it developed that, I have it in the book, I've forgotten the exact figure, that he had sponsored 34 or 44 orphans of the Blitz in London, and he paid for their upkeep and their career, you see. But there he died bitter and lonely, and he was such a horrible bigot. Douglas invented a card game dedicated to McReynolds. It was called Son of a Bitch. So, and I think Roosevelt knew it was doomed, but he did, you know, he lost the battle, but he won the war.
Right. Yeah.
It was embarrassing in a way, but what did he care? You know, he won every state except Maine and Vermont, and second term was riding high. Then came the third term. I'm old enough, I voted for him in the fourth term still. It's my first vote.
In your book, you talk about what motivates the presidents when they decide to select justices, and you have, I forget, four or five general criteria. Could you expound on those a little bit?
What motivates a president?
Yeah. And what are the criteria that he considers when he decides who should be elevated to the Supreme Court? What were some of the
four?
The four.
You know, it's hard to quantify, but you can quantify to some extent there are four criteria. These are in no particular order. I'm happy to say one of them is strict merit, you know. And Hoover was forced into appointing Cardozo. He tried his best not to appoint him, but the entire country wanted Cardozo. And Senator Borah, who was chairman of the Judiciary Committee, went to see Hoover and to try Hoover into appointing Cardozo. Borah was no particular friend of New Yorkers or Jews, but the man was a giant in the judicial horizon. So Hoover said, we already have someone of that race on the court. And Boris said, whoever advised you of that isn't worthy of his judgment, and you should not even mention that sort of thing. And then Hoover said, well, we already have two very good justices on the court from New York. And that was true. It was Hughes, the Chief Justice, and Stone, the Associate Justice. And Boris said, well, geography shouldn't make any difference. Moreover, he said, I just talked to Justice Stone, and Justice Stone said to tell the president that he would resign in order to make room for Cardozo. So Hoover finally said, all right, here's my list of candidates. And Boris looked at it, and he said, your list is fine, Mr. President, but you handed it to me upside down, because Cardozo was at the bottom, you see. So this was strictly a merit appointment. And Hoover, in his biography, said, the finest thing I ever did was to appoint Benjamin Nathan Cardozo, you know, to the Supreme Court. So merit is one, obviously. Another one, obviously, is personal or political friendship. One of the best examples, most recent examples, is Abe Fortas, you know. Lyndon Johnson, the master arm twister and stylist, you know, he got Goldberg off the court. Goldberg was appointed by Kennedy, not Johnson. And we wanted Fortas on the court, and Fortas didn't really want to go. And I've never forgotten that TV performance. There was Mrs. Goldberg in tears, and Arthur Goldberg looking miserable. Mrs. Fortas looking furious, you know, she didn't want him to go on the court. She wanted him to continue in the big seven-figure law firm, whatever it was. And there was Fortas looking very unhappy, and there was Lyndon Johnson smiling away, having a great time. And he managed to, you know, he had managed to get Goldberg off. Fortas had never agreed to go on the court, but Johnson called him and said, I've arranged a TV appearance of the next justice. The news has gone out to the world. Now, if you want to say no now, you go ahead and say it on TV, you see. So, anyway, that was an illustration of personal friendship. Another one was Justice Kennedy's appointment of Byron White. They were very close friends. They were raising hell together in London, you know. And they were in the same PT boat, weren't they, or something like that.
White had investigated the PT-109 accident.
That's it. So that was a real buddy, personally and politically. White had been chairman of the Kennedy campaign in Colorado, I know. The third reason is a nominee's real politics. That doesn't necessarily have to be Democratic or Republican, but that is very important. Taft appointed three of six appointees as Democrats. And when the chairman of the National Republican Party at the time, his name was Rosewater, who happened to be a distant relative of my wife, and she's not a Republican. But anyway, when he heard that, you know, he said to the president, why do you appoint these? These are all Democrats. He said, we've got a lot of good Republicans. And Taft said, I know that, but they are my kind of Democrats, and I know how they're going to vote on the big issues. And he was right, you see. The real politics may be the key reason of all the four, if one could quantify it. The fourth one, and the most contentious one nowadays, is the appearance of a requirement of what I call representativeness on the court, namely that you have to pick people with an eye towards their constituency, racial constituency, gender constituency. At one time, geography played a major role until Teddy Roosevelt came along, who said, I'm not appointing geography, I'm appointing human beings. Religion played a major role at one time until we got to Truman. When Murphy died, you know, he was the only Catholic on the bench, and everyone expected Truman to appoint a Roman Catholic. And Truman, of course, you know, was never at a loss to say things and do things that he wanted, said, I'm not appointing people for their religion, I'm just appointing a good person, so he said. And he didn't appoint a Catholic, he appointed Tom Clark, I think, at the time, or maybe it was Sherman Newton. So those are the four. Nowadays, representativeness is very important. And I am sure that a Hispanic is in line for the court because we haven't had one. And Bush has a number of them that would qualify. I think we mentioned, did you talk to me about the Fifth Circuit last night?
Yes,
Emilio Garza.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. I know Emilio Garza. He was a finalist in the Souter appointment. He told me the story, how he didn't get it. And at the same time, Edith Jones didn't get it. She was the last finalist. She was defeated 3-2 in the White House, you know. But Garza would be the obvious choice, but I think he's too conservative for the makeup of the Senate at the moment. He's opposed to abortion, for example. So is Edith Jones. But he has two in his cabinet, of course. No, he has one now. And that is Gonzalez, ex-Supreme Court Chief of Texas. Now, Gonzalez, you know, has not established any kind of paper trail. I don't know what kind of counsel he has been. I have no idea. His record is not excessively impressive, but he would be a safe appointee, and he would fulfill the absence, you know, of a of a Hispanic. It's a very big voting group now, so I think you can expect that.
Actually, I was just thinking, if they do appoint, presumably a Hispanic would presumably be a Roman Catholic,
yeah,
and that wouldn't that make the majority on the court?
Well, this is the first time in the history of the court that we do not have a Protestant majority. It's the first time after 220 years. They have three Catholics on the court, yeah, two Jews, and four Protestants. Now, that shouldn't make any difference anyway, but
shouldn't,
of course
but
it
it's
does.
Correspondent.
It does make a difference in the eyes of some people. But I think the presence of a Hispanic candidate is an obvious one. And, you know, Estrada probably would be a logical one for the court because he's so highly qualified. But he's been so damaged now by the Democrats that I don't know whether he'll ever get through, you know.
Sure.
Someone asked me from the audience last night whether there had ever been a filibuster of Supreme Court candidates, and had never had been.
I thought, wasn't there a filibuster for, you had just mentioned his name.
Who, Fortas?
Fortas.
What, it wasn't a filibuster for his appointment. Well, what happened was it was for his promotion to the court, to the Chief Justiceship.
Okay.
What happened was the Senate would not allow the necessary votes, and they were filibustering on that particular issue, you know, whether or not to have closure. And it didn't get to that, but they just wouldn't. There weren't enough votes for him to actually vote, but he was already on the court. But you're quite right, I should have mentioned that yesterday, because one might say that that was an illustration of a filibuster, but it was a very technical illustration, you know, because he was already on the bench. And Warren had stepped down, and Johnson wanted Fortas to replace Warren. And when they wouldn't vote on Fortas, well, he remained on the court for another year, and Warren announced they won't take Abe, so they'll have me again for another year, you see. And Warren didn't step down until 1969, and that was the year when Fortas resigned from the court. That was the only illustration of a Supreme Court justice resigning from the court under fire, you know, because once you're up there, you don't get them out.
Mm-hmm.
It's a wonderful position. If I could have picked one for me, that's where I would have gone, you know. But I'm not a lawyer, so I would have been vetoed. It's a really incredible effort, and it is it's a wonderful institution. It is really quite unique, almost, in the country. As I've said a couple times before, I can only think of one other justice who has been honored with a kind of center of the type that's been done here so beautifully, and that is Justice Brennan, in whose honor a center was established in New York at New York University. But what Greg Peterson and his associates have done here is really remarkable. both professionally and architecturally. And this house is, you know, this is really a unique institution in so many ways. And obviously it has a lot of community support, which is not always forthcoming. There's so many competing problems, but Jamestown has obviously come out full force in favor of it, and so many aspects of the center are worthy of national attention, and I think they're beginning to get it and should get it. It's a community effort, you know, which is really unusual and worthwhile, and it's the people who, you know, who organized this and been responsible for it ought to be commended. And I think under Mr. Peterson's leadership, have really achieved a memorable institution.
Obviously, I took a look at your book here. I know you've been involved studying, obviously, the history of the Supreme Court. I mean, when you look back on that, your impressions of what Justice Jackson, I mean, his place in history as the years go on, I mean, where do you think he's going to be rated?
Well, he was a very important figure on the court. Unfortunately, he only had 13 years, and actually only 12, because he spent 1 year in Nuremberg. He made major contributions through his pen, his prose, and his facility with the written word was remarkable. So much of what he said is quotable. And not only that, but it also comes to the heart of the judicial process. Unfortunately, the relatively brief tenure, his absence in Nuremberg, doubt on his performance. Who we remembered most was Ings, and he gave a brilliant, as a member of the court, in you know, he was an important figure in upholding New Deal legislation. He wrote a good many of the important commerce cases. I think I probably ignored that last night, but this young man brought it back to my attention. I mean, he was a very important figure in writing opinions that upheld the Agriculture Adjustment Act and the NRAs. But his contribution in the realm of civil rights and liberties is also, it was towering. His dissent in the Japanese evacuation case would probably today become majority opinion. At the time, he was one of three who dissented. He also, before he went to Nuremberg, was a very significant figure in making possible an expansion of the First Amendment's freedom of expression concept, especially. He supported the plight of small religious groups, for example, such as Jehovah Witnesses, to refuse to bow down before the flag, to refuse to provide viva voce prayers. He was a champion of the underdog in many ways. But again, there just wasn't enough time. Initially, while on the court, you know, his main job became as a leader of those who secured Roosevelt's New Deal. And when he came back from Nuremberg, you know, he was somewhat changed in his political Weltanschauung, but he still could be counted upon to be a liberal on a good many issues. But there's no question that he had toned down his earlier championship of some of the more questionable problems that arose under the civil liberties concept. He wrote a number of significant opinions, but unfortunately, you know, he was not accorded sufficient time once he came back home. But in the eyes of some people, there were two Jacksons, the pre-Nuremberg Jackson and the post-Nuremberg Jackson. And one could make a case for that in terms of, oversimplifiedly, the conservative and liberal spectrum. And I always believed in that concept myself, but I've come to change my mind somewhat. While he indeed became somewhat more conservative, it wasn't as clear-cut a conversion as some of the commentators say. Unfortunately, we're still waiting for the key biography on Justice Jackson. We have a celebration by Mr. Gerhard, which is a lovely book, but he doesn't dig very deep in some of the problems And other than that, we have to await the work of some people. There are several people at work now who I hope will come forth with a major biography. It often takes a long time to produce biographies of Supreme Court justices. It was only recently that Cardozo had one, and the author worked on it for 40 years, you see. And so that happens. Oh, thank you.
You have more questions? Okay.
You can go ahead.
All right. Richard Nixon. Richard Nixon looked at the Constitution and saw that it was the president shall nominate and the Senate shall provide advice and consent. And obviously he had a run of bad luck as far as he was concerned and took it pretty personal and felt that that particular clause within the Constitution gave him a right. What a comment on that view?
Well,
or even the whole story. It's a kind of a bizarre story.
He was a totally politicized leader, of course. He was also a person who was suspicious of mankind. He had very few close friends. He was very bright, and he had an instinct for the jugular, which helped him. He also was capable of achieving certain kinds of goals which he would never have allowed others to achieve, such as the opening of China. He surrounded himself with some people who were highly talented, such as Henry Kissinger. But Nixon was an unhappy man in many ways, and that translated itself into, I think, his administration in a good many ways. He hated the press. He hated criticism. He achieved a good deal. He was far less conservative than people would normally court him. But I think that ultimately his pettiness and his inability to take a defeat caused his downfall. The Watergate thing was totally unnecessary, of course, but he got caught. And he was willing to try to lie his way out of it. He will generally be regarded as below average as a president, perhaps as a failure in some ways. I never cared for him. I appreciated the fact that he was a student of history, but he personalized everything, and I was always uncomfortable with him. You know, so I remember in 1972, when the choice was between Nixon and McGovern, I thought I wanted to move out of the country to get a different choice. It was very difficult. There were six colleagues of mine at Virginia who had never voted anything but Democratic. They didn't want to vote for McGovern, despite the fact that I had a PhD in political science, you know. And they couldn't vote for Nixon, so they did the unforgivable. They didn't vote, you see, because I have to vote, because my PhD dissertation was on compulsory voting. I came out against it, but it was quite a choice to make. So I did vote for McGovern at the time. I don't know whether I satisfied your question on Nixon.
Talk about the judicial process. He nominated.
Nixon. Nixon, of course, nominated Rehnquist. He nominated Powell. Mm-hmm. He was very disappointed in Powell because Powell, when he was head of the American Bar Association, had supported the president in his attempt to harness certain subversive groups. And he also supported legislation. Powell at the time supported wiretapping legislation. When he came on the Supreme Court, he changed all that completely. And he wrote a major opinion denying those kinds of powers to the president, and Nixon filled the air with expletives at the time about this man. Nixon also appointed Warren Burger, who was a faithful Republican and was a journeyman Chief Justice. He was, you know, just an average Chief Justice, but he was a superb administrator, and he established a number of judicial process devices, such as the Judicial Fellows, and did a lot to remodel and revivify the building. He was a good administrator. He and Taft were the leading administrative genii on the court. But as a jurist proved, Burger was third rate, really. But Nixon appointed him as Chief Justice, and I think those were the only ones he had, the three. I may have forgotten someone else. Oh yes, he appointed Blackmun, of course. And he was very happy with Blackmun for a while. But then Blackmun changed from being a sure vote with Burger to a sure, Brennan got a hold of him. And then, of course, Blackmun wrote Roe v. Wade. By that time, Nixon had resigned. But so that was Burger, Blackmun, and Rehnquist and Powell, I think that was it. Now, of those, you know, I think the truly outstanding ones were Rehnquist and Powell. Burger, as I said, was just an average leader. He loved the court, and he was far less doctrinaire on the conservative line than Nixon had hoped he would be, but because it was the Burger court that introduced affirmative action, and it was the Burger court that handed down the first pro-feminist gender decisions, you see. And Nixon was not amused with those, although he really was not as opposed to aspects of affirmative action as might seem to be the case. Nixon's main complaint with Burger, the Burger court, was the introduction and support of busing, racially tinged busing. That was Nixon's main complaint about his appointees. And of course he was livid with Powell because he thought he had a Nixon candidate there, and Powell had reverted to being a conscientious jurist, you know, and that was his role. And of course none of the Nixon appointees voted for him in United States versus Nixon. Rehnquist did not sit because he was an assistant attorney general at the time. And while Rehnquist does not usually step down very readily, doesn't recuse himself very readily, obviously had to in that case. So that was 8-0, you know. And the opinion had to be written by Burger. I mean, you know, I told you yesterday that there was a claim that Stewart wrote the opinion, but anyway, Burger was the pronounced
author.
Well,
let's stop and let's talk about that, because that's a great story of how the galley drafts of one of your book got to Chief Justice Burger, and he had a reaction to that.
Well, he objected to something I had said in the book. I was discussing the role of the Chief Justice, and I said that he was really just first among equals, you know, powers, you know, primus inter pares, but that one of his important powers was to assign cases when he was in the majority. Of course, when he's not, the highest ranking associate justice in the minority would. At the moment, you know, when Rehnquist is not in the majority, Stevens will assign the case, and he's had a good many opportunities to do that. Well, anyway, I had, in attempting to explain the Chief Justice's role, I had said that an example would be of that self-assignment was a device which the Chief Justice often utilized, that in highly significant cases he would assign the writing to himself. Well, and I said, as for example, Chief Justice Burger did in United States versus Nixon. Then I had open paren, although it is widely rumored in Washington that Justice Stewart wrote the opinion, closed paren. Well, he got a hold of that somehow. I'm sure his clerks pointed it out to him, and he called me into Washington to roast me and gave me hell. and he really let me have it. He said, I wrote this damn opinion myself on yellow foolscap in pencil, and maybe Stuart gave me a snippet, but that was my opinion. I want you to say that. I want you to do that. Well, I ultimately took the paren out, but that was after the edition had already been published, and what had been a rather nice relationship with Chief Justice Burger disappeared. And I moved from Henry to Professor Abraham, you see. So. But he was, you know, he was very, very much involved. He had must have had one of his clerks highlight with a yellow pen every reference to Burger in the book, and there were a ton, of course. And they were all outlined on his desk when he called me in. You know, he had different packets, different postures on what I had said and hadn't said. So he was certainly very human, and but I did lose out on a nice contact after that.
Have you found that, and just to digress a little bit, as you've written about the court, inevitably, as objective as you can be about the court, you're inevitably going to affect the subjectivity of the reader, especially if it's a member of the court. What other incidents have you had where they've had a...
Well, my essay on Justice Stevens is not a heroic approval of his particular jurisprudence, and I've been fairly critical of his... he's never been a leader, really. He could have been very bright, very capable. He was a clerk to Justice Rutledge, and people forget, he was appointed as a Republican by a Republican president. He hasn't voted along that line in a Coons age, you know. But anyway, I was complimentary on a lot of issues, but I was also critical of him. I think the essay in the book will show that, too. Well, the court has a series twice a year on during which it gives lectures on various aspects of history. And this last fall's lecture, no, I guess it was a year ago, time goes so quickly, was on John Marshall. And I was invited to give one of the four lectures on John Marshall. And they asked me to speak on Marshall's relationship with Jefferson and Jackson, and I wasn't going to do that. I would have had to do too much work on that. And it came at a bad time for me. I was all booked up. So I said I'd like to do something else. I'd like to talk about the justices that were with Marshall, the associate justices on the court. There were something like 13 or 14 during his 34-year tenure. And they said that was all right. Well, there's a custom that each of these speakers, there are always four in the fall and four in the spring, are introduced by a Supreme Court justice. And they asked me, and I said, well, I would be honored by anyone, but don't take Justice Thomas because I'm on his shit list, you see. So I can't. They said, well, no, of course not. So, all right. Anyway, although I thought I had been very nice about him in my essay, but that's a long other story. He objected to something I had written. Be that as it may, the justice who introduced me was Justice Stevens, you see. And I was a little squeamish about that. And he received me in his chambers before the talk, and he was very nice. And he said, I read your essay. He said, it's okay. It's all right. It's all right. And he was very nice to me. He couldn't have been nicer. He didn't go to the reception. He said his wife made him do something else, and he couldn't have been more pleasant, you know. And I'm quite critical about certain aspects of his view of the function of a jurist. But so they can be very nice. They can, of course, they can also brush you off. You have to be very careful how you deal with them if you get a chance to talk with them, you know. And they don't like any kind of smart alecky comments. Justice Rehnquist, before he was Chief Justice, I remember, talked to my students. I always tried to get a justice in the spring and in the fall to talk to my graduate seminar. And I usually succeeded, and Justice Rehnquist agreed to speak to them. Well, you know, there were only about 15 or so people in the class, and he spoke. He was very nice about it. But one of the students, took his picture without asking, and he blew a fuse, Rehnquist, and almost walked out.
Really?
And then another
This is good to know.
Another student had brought in one of his books and had put it on the desk. You see, all this was, I had no idea what was going on, had put it on his desk with a note, please sign. And Rehnquist said, I'm not doing that, he said. You may ask me, you say, can't tell me. So they can be edgy, you know, if they, obviously, if they want to, you got to be very careful. And, you know, that student had his nerve. I had a nice talk with him afterwards. But then Rehnquist, he did agree to have his picture taken then, you know, but at his beck and call. And I have it, but he looks a little glum on it, but that's all right. He's very decisive, and he would be a good executive as well as a good lawyer. I don't think I've ever had any kind of a run-in with any of them to the extent that I've seen. Some of them are very idiosyncratic. I was on a bicentennial committee which went to Israel in 1987, and one of the members of the committee was the then Judge Ruth Bader Ginsburg, who was on the Court of Appeals for the District of Columbia. And she was difficult, you know, but after 3 or 4 days she became friendly, and she sent me some of her stuff and I sent me some of hers, and she said, call me Ruth, and you know, call me Henry, and I wouldn't do it in public, but she can be very nice. She can also ignore me completely, because she, when I retired, she sent a wonderful photo, framed photo of herself with a lovely message. 3 weeks later, there was a luncheon to which we were both invited, and she acted as if she'd never seen me in her life, you see. So I guess that's, it's a little inhuman, but still, that's all that happens. But the warmest persons I ever knew on the court, now I don't want to give the impression that I knew all or even many of the justices personally. I mean, I've talked to a lot of them, but they don't give interviews very readily. But the warmest people I've ever known among those were Justice Powell and Justice Brennan. Justice Powell was a real friend. He came to Kenyon for my son's graduation. And Justice Brennan, although his jurisprudence would not have dovetailed with mine on many issues, was lovely. His daughter was a student of mine, and he was always very warm, very powerful member of the court, you know, very successful in marshaling the court. He captured Souter, you know, after Souter got on the bench. So Souter saw him every day as long as he lived. And Powell was a genuinely warm person, and so was Brennan, and Justice Black was a very sweet guy. Now, Douglas was not nice, you know, didn't care about people, particularly, especially not males. His attention was directed towards females most of the time. And others were indifferent, you know. White was difficult, too. He was, and certainly you couldn't call him Whizzer. He hated that. He was called Whizzer White. Stewart could be a little remote. I once said something and he didn't like it. It was at a Brennan party, and we were talking about schools, and he had attended Yale undergrad and law school, and I said, I guess you found a home at Yale, and he took offense to that and walked away. So, see, I had a big mouth with that, but I didn't really mean anything. Anyway, I had a lot of scotch in me by then, because but they're very human, and some of them are more difficult than others. Justice Souter will not give speeches. I got him to talk to my students, but that doesn't count, you know, so he was very nice. And Justice Breyer gave me all of 8 minutes for my students. I didn't like that, but, you know, he came. He is a professor on the bench. He asks a lot of questions and becomes very specific. He starts by, he takes his hand and puts it over his head and leans forward, and he lectures, you see. And Justice Scalia, whom I do know, who's a lot of fun, he's the court clown. I also think he probably has the best mind on the court, and I guess Rehnquist is right up there too. So they're fascinating people, and most of them probably deserve to be up there. It was hard to find some to consider failures, but And I think some of us who rated them, you know, probably did so in partial ignorance, because some names on the court I never heard of until I got involved in the project, you know. Who ever heard of McKinley on the court? That was a president, I know, but that was a different McKinley. And so I think the tendency was to place these people either as average, or if they had done nothing at all, perhaps even below that. But the failures included Chief Justice Vincent, for example, and they included Butler and McReynolds, usually. And there were a couple of others. Whittaker was the one contemporary justice that was usually put, and Minton was another one. Minton himself said that he did not do a good job and he was glad to get off the court. He wrote a letter to Justice Frankfurter, which he had not had any judicial experience. And a requirement we wouldn't have had a lot, and said, I agree with you, judicial experience, and I'm the best example. He was appointed a group of four.
Here, but you had a chance at Brett.
Yeah, he was very nice. Book, a disquisition on, because Dean Warren of the, well, they were playing tennis. No, it was different. So, he wife Josephine to my daughter Josephine. And then I had reviewed his, which he authored, and the authority authorized by the president. And Chief Justice was there, said to him, I was black. Then I talking about war ever since. And of course, I was not on the boosting and so. Vanity of considerations and appointment. And she tried to get interviews with all of them. And I helped her get started with Justice Brennan, you know, which was easy. And she managed to get to, and Justice Marshall wouldn't talk to her, and there was one more, but otherwise it was all very well. Well, she wrote to Justice Scalia to ask for the interview, and she said, I'd like to talk to you about the Catholic seat. So he wrote back and said, so that's what you think I'm representing, the Catholic seat? I think you better talk to Bill Brennan, you know. And of course, Brennan, you know, was so anti any kind of involvement of the state in church matters and vice versa, that he went to mass every day, but you know, he was a very good Catholic, but he was first of all a First Amendment backer. So, and she wrote a good dissertation, and that was published. Interesting. They are fascinating people, you know. They can be rude, and they can be very nice, you know. Oh, I think, I mean, personally think it's a good court. It's, they do their job. This court is approaching the record of being together. They're in their ninth year now of no change. There was none in this century. There was one in the 19th century, which I think may have the same record or a little more. I can't quite finger it. I haven't really done the work on it. It would be easy to do, but they're a good court by and large. You know, a lot of people, there's some nasty books about the court, mostly written by very, very liberal law school professors, you know, but how this court has become reactionary is really not true. For example, in the First Amendment, they've been very liberal, for example, and they've certainly held the line to some extent in separation of church and state, and, well, you know, while they've been willing to allow certain kinds of abortion legislation by the states, you know, they have confirmed Roe v. Wade any number of times. They've even confirmed, in a Rehnquist opinion, the Miranda decision, from which he, you know, has dissented all his public life, you know. And he affirmed that on the, he called it an established culture. And there is, of course, the question of precedent, you know. They're supposed to abide by some precedent. Except as one justice once said, I'll be damned if I'm going to abide by some precedent invented by some other justice, you know. So if it's justice invented, hereby it's justice destroyed. And Holmes used to say, don't talk to me about the precedent established by Henry II in the 11th century, you see. So I think it's a good court. It has some very able people on it. It may not be a great court like the court, you know, the Hughes court in its early stages with Brandeis and Pedroso and so forth. I think it'll go down as a good court. They do their job. they one criticism against the current court is that they don't take enough cases. See, when I went to college in the 40s, early and late 40s, they took 150 cases a year. Now they take half that many. And the reason is they think the lower courts should do their job, you know. And as Frankfurter said in one opinion, Julian Mack of the district court in Chicago wrote this opinion, that's good enough for me. Because Frankfurter was conservative in the state, he was a personal liberal, he was conservative in terms of the court's role. He always said, when in doubt, don't. So when in doubt, don't take the case. When in doubt, don't reach the constitutional issue. You know, so they only take about 75 cases now, 73, 74, 75. And Renfrews distributes them rather nicely. They all take their turn, they have to. No one there could get away with writing only an opinion and a half or something like that for the year. So, you know, and they've had some, the court, they've had some really outstanding people on it, and they're very able, and I think they, you know, as I said, they may not be a great court, but they are certainly a perfectly good court, and no matter what one's partisan view may be politically, you have every shade represented on the court. And of course, it's not supposed to play any role at all, politics, but the court has a tripartite function. As I said last night, it is a legal institution, it is a political institution, you see, and it's a governmental institution, so there's politics involved. And sometimes it has to bite the bullet and take cases which cannot be resolved by any other branch, and that includes Bush v. Gore, you know. If that had gone into the House, you would have had a zoo, you know. Although, actually, if it had been thrown into the House, Bush would have won hands down, because there were 28 legislatures. Each state got only one vote. There were 28 legislatures which had both branches as Republican. But, so then they had to bite the bullet in Korematsu and in, you know, cases like Roe v. Wade and so forth. So Hughes used to say the Constitution is what the court says it is. That's oversimplification, but it's probably true. In theory, it does not have the last word. In theory, we have the last word. It was pretty hard to get our views up there, you know. And the public doesn't know much about the court. But the court always gets the number one ranking from the public, with the executive second and the legislature third. They place the legislature down with the sand and gravel of the unions and so forth, you see. The court is always, even after Bush v. Gore, from a 63% approval, it went down to 61 and then it went up again, you know. And that, I was surprised they took that case. I didn't think they would take it. But the Florida Supreme Court had made such a mess of it that I was not surprised that ultimately they took it. It was very exciting because the clerk of the court spoke in my lecture series on the very day, the night that the Supreme Court stayed the election in Florida, and he had gone to his country home on the lake in Virginia to spend a nice weekend there. When he got a call from the office, he said, get your ass up to Washington. They're sitting tomorrow and they're coming down on Tuesday. So had to do that. But that was how it had to be done, you know. And of course there was such anger, and some of the commentary was not very judicious and not very factual. It was a shame it was 5-4. Actually it was 7-2 on the 14th Amendment equal protection issue. But Breyer and Souter, who joined the majority on the 7-2 concept of the case, said, well, it was a violation of equal protection, but it really wasn't bad enough, I think, that you could have authorized some continuation of the count, which had been confined to four heavily Democratic counties, you know. Maybe an all-state count should have been done, but there were constitutional barriers in the way. Time periods and the Electoral College. So they had to bite the bullet, and they got a lot of hell for it, but didn't harm them really, except in the literature.